To our New Look Rush Hour concerts. Thank you so much for coming. It's so great to see you. So we are now trying to offer something a little bit different from the normal sort of two quartets and then everybody goes home. So we're just trying to be a little bit more informal in approach and maybe a bit more interaction with the audience. We've got the lovely Ron Butlin with us, who's going to give us some marvellous insights about Beethoven before we play Beethoven. So that'd be something to look forward to. I'd like to also welcome Rebecca Smith, who's joining us as guest artist for this concert. So thank you so much, Rebecca. So think of it like you're at a five-star restaurant and you're getting a taster menu. We're offering a tasters, and we have probably one of the greatest repertoires in the chamber music, the string quartet. So we're offering bits and pieces of quartets, thinking more about the sort of historical context of them. We're going to introduce each one of them to you today. And later on in the program, we're going to offer a curveball of the Bartok two violin duets, which are absolutely wonderful. You will so enjoy them. I can say that because I'm not playing them. So we're going to start with the Dumka from Dvorak's quartet, Opus 51 in E-flat major. This quartet was also known as Slavonic Quartet. It was written in 1879. Dvorak was the eldest of 14 children, I learned last night, which is pretty impressive. He learned the violin from an early age and obviously was precociously gifted. He later saw sense, I was very glad to meet him, and took up the viola, you know, like you would. So he writes wonderfully for strings and is well known for his marvellous singing melodies. The Dumka as a form has no real parallel in our tradition. It's basically a Czech form, which is contrasting sorrowful music and really joyful music. So I found a good quote last night, which is, this is a delightfully ambivalent world where grief and joy are juxtaposed somehow without conflict. So this is the Dumka from Dvorak's Quartet. Relax, enjoy your drinks, and hope you enjoy the evening.
Thank you. Thank you. Sorry, I'm just pausing for a second just to check that I can read Beethoven's letters. I can read them, but if I can see them is the thing, because the lights have changed since we did the test. However, I won't. Oh, God, hi, Tech. Thanks very much, that's great. Now then, my name is Ron Butland, and it's my pleasure, after that Dvorak, which is lovely, to hear, we'll just go back back to the beginning of the 19th century. And I'm going to say a few words about Beethoven, and then I'm going to read excerpts from three of his letters that were written around the time of the... Well, they make reference to the Opus 18 set of string quartets, of which you're going to hear a movement immediately after. Now, Dvorak came from many children, one of many children, as Kathy's told us. Beethoven, there was only three of them, but Beethoven's dad was a musician. He sang in a choir, but he was an awful man. I mean, this is, everyone agrees about this. He was a drunk, he was a bully, he was just terrible. And the moment he saw the slightest spark of talent in Beethoven, he immediately really forced them to learn the piano and other some stringed instruments as well, and also the horn. But it was the piano in particular that he showed talent for. And this is, we're talking about a boy that's maybe 5 or 6 years old. This is in the 1770s. And his father was such a bully that he would make him practice till, and Beethoven refers to this later in life, not just once, it must have really got to him. It would make him practice until the blood came out from under his fingernails. Imagine how awful that is. And also when his dad was out boozing at night, he would bring all his cronies back afterwards, you know, 1 or 2 in the morning or whatever, the pubs shut and Bonn where they lived. And he would get the young Ludwig up out of his bed at maybe 2 in the morning so he could play for his friends. Hardly the best upbringing. And it's not surprising that Beethoven legged it as soon as he could. When he was about 16, 17, and he went to Vienna for the first time. Didn't stay long, he had to come back for family reasons, and then settled there finally. He went in his early 20s, 1792. And what he did was, he actually capitalized the finger bleeding. He turned to good use, and he became one of the most sought after pianists in the aristocratic circles. He would play and melt their hearts, and he would rouse their passions and all the rest of it. And he began to compose as well. By the time he was in his mid-20s, he'd got a couple of piano concertos that you could then play with an orchestra. And by then, a first symphony, just in 1800. And about the same time, we've got the Opus 18 string quartets. So the first letter, his writing, and he's a very assertive character. He's not like Haydn, you know, with the kind of, or Mozart, you know, with the buckles and the wigs and all the kind of court dress. You never see a portrait of Beethoven wearing a wig. You know, he really is a man of, at the cutting edge of things, a real democrat. Remember, the French Revolution had only just happened. So it was really kind of a very vibrant time. So he's very assertive when dealing with publishers. He's not going to take anything from them. And he very often sold the same piece several times to different publishers without telling them. But he had to do that because copyright law was almost non-existent. And then he refers to this in the first letter. At the beginning he talks about just he refers to the quartets that he didn't send to this publisher. It's to Kapellmeister Hofmeister, who was also a music publisher, in Leipzig, Vienna, December 15, 1800. My dear brother in art, I've often intended to reply to your inquiries, but I'm so dreadfully lazy at letter writing. It's usually a good while before I can bring myself to write the dry letters of the alphabet instead of music. I have, however, forced myself at last to answer you. I regret you did not ask, or I would have offered you my quartets, Opus 18, as well as many other things I've now disposed of. But if you are a conscientious publisher, as your fellow publishers are, who grind us poor composers to death, you will know pretty well how to extract an ample profit from the moment the works appear. Farewell. Rest assured, my dear brother in art, of the esteem of your Beethoven. So he's really telling him. The very tragic thing that happened during that period was that he began to have signs of going deaf. And this got worse and worse until he became, towards, you know, the middle and later on in his life, almost totally deaf. And this he refers to, and his tragedy, he was unable to tell people. But this is probably the first time he ever acknowledges it to someone, a friend of his called Carl Amenda. July 1, 1800. My dear, my good Amenda, my warm-hearted friend, I read your last letter with deep emotion mingled with pain and pleasure. Oh, how I wish that you were here in Vienna, for I am terribly unhappy. My most precious faculty, my hearing, has greatly deteriorated. Even while you were still with me, I was aware of the symptoms, though said nothing. But now it's much worse. And diseases of this kind are the most difficult to cure. How sad my life is now. All I write I can dispose of five times over and be well paid into the bargain. I've been writing a good deal recently and will send you some of my compositions. And then immediately he's back to what's really hurting him. Oh, how happy I would be if I had perfect hearing. As it is, I must withdraw from everything. And thus will my best years pass away without my achieving all my talents and powers have commanded me to do. Oh, how melancholy is this resignation in which I must take refuge. I had determined to rise above it all. But how? Oh, I beg you, keep my deafness a profound secret. Confide it to no one. Write to me frequently. Your letters, however short, cheer me and console me. I hope to hear from you soon. And by the way, do not let the quartet I gave you, Opus 18, number 1, don't lend it to anyone. I've altered it drastically, having only now learned how to write quartets properly. And this, I fancy, you will know, notice immediately you receive it. Now farewell, my dear kind friend, and if by any chance I can serve you here, you have only to command me. And finally, the real bugbear of all creative, well, I'm a novelist and a poet, and he speaks for all of us, I think. Because he's talking about wretched editions of his work. And one of the most wretched of all was Opus 18. The Printer's Frolic, it's sometimes described as. My God. I blame computers. I mean, back before computers, 3 mistakes in a book was a sacking offence. Now with computers, you get 3 to a page. Right, so, and also this is him arguing with a publisher and refusing to accept what they want. Do you mean to rush post haste? It's to Hofmeister, the same publisher earlier. Do you mean to rush post haste to the devil, gentlemen, proposing I should write such a sonata? During the revolutionary fever, a thing like this might have been appropriate, but now, when everything is returning to the old well-worn rut, such a sonata as this, no, it won't do, and I will have none of it. Here's my answer in fastest tempo. The lady can have a sonata from me, and I'm willing to adopt a general outline of her plan without adhering to the keys she mentions. The price, 50 ducats. For this, she could keep the work for a year for her own amusement. After the lapse of a year, however, the sonata reverts to me. I will publish it. If she considers it an honour, she can request me to dedicate it to her. Hermolo has recently published my Opus 18 quartets, full of faults, errors, both large and small. They swarm in my quartets like little fishes in the sea. They are innumerable. My skin, in truth, is a mass of punctures and scratches from this so finely etched edition of my quartets. Now, farewell, and think of me as I do of you, Beethoven. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ron. Ron's in such demand, he's got to rush on to another engagement now, so we're lucky to grab him for that short moment in time. So we're going to play the last movement of Beethoven, Opus 18, number 3, hopefully without any of those errors that Beethoven mentioned. And out of all that anguish and difficulty he was going through, he writes a piece that's just unadulterated joy, really, high spirits. So enjoy.
Okay, so we're going to continue with a selection of Bartok's duos for two violins. Bartok travelled a lot and collected lots of folk music. He went around Central Europe and North Africa and Turkey and collected so many tunes and recorded all the people in the villages singing. I think you can even hear some of these recordings. And he assimilated this music into his own in language, and the folk music became part of his highly sophisticated style. These duets are kind of, we hear some of the more unadulterated folk elements. They're very short. I first came across them when my first violin teacher introduced them and said we should play some duets. And so it was a lovely way of kind of playing with someone else. And then later I played them with my sister. I think there's an old cassette recording of us playing them. And before we perform them, we say to the audience, I'm sorry, there can be some clashing sounds in this. Because I suppose it was for us, it was the first time we heard some more dissonant kind of modern music. But they're absolutely delightful. Each one has its own character. And because they're so short, we thought we'd make a kind of little operetta out of this transformation of these short pieces. So Rebecca here is going to set the scene.
Yes, so we're going to give you six of these duos. The first one, picture, if you like, Budapest, 100 years ago. It's New Year's Eve, but it's also the day of a couple's wedding. So we start the proceedings with a very rambunctious dance. It's called Dancing Song. And then the next one we will play is the day after, and everybody's kind of quietly contemplating what the new year will have in store for them. And it's a very soothing, calming, almost like a lullaby. It's very tender, the second one. So we've got everybody at the party, including the newlyweds, calmly making plans for the future. But unfortunately,
at this moment, a mosquito flies in, a very angry mosquito. It flies in through the window, and he's no ordinary mosquito. He's in fact, reincarnation of Dracula, who's just flown in from Transylvania. And he spies the juiciest bit of flesh in the room and goes straight for the bride. And within an hour, she's dead. And because he's very media conscious and he knows he's being live streamed, he does a special kind of mosquito dance. Anyway, and so the bride is dead within the hour, and everyone, the groom, is beside himself. He's crazy, and so he you'd expect him to lament straight away, but he actually dances a wild dance, a Ruffinian polymaker, and only when he's staggering home and waking up in the gutter does he realise what's happened really, and then he sings laments, and it's called Sadness. And he's really going for it. And then he's interrupted by a kind of distant sound of bagpipes. And he realizes that maybe there's a new future in Scotland. And well, that's you'll hear that. Yes, we wish him all the best. Also, I think my 3-week-old son is in the audience, so I'd love to dedicate this to him. Although not such a tragic story, but just...
Thank you.
give us some marvellous insights into.
So we thought we'd finish with the last segment of the Britten Third Quartet, which is actually the last piece he wrote that was fully completed. And he wrote it for the Amadeus Quartet on their request. It's absolutely a fantastic piece, and it was written 30 years after his previous quartet, so quite a big gap. So it's really Britten, I think, at his very best. It's a sort of scherzo movement, this burlesque, and it's quite gruff and harsh in places, and he asks for quite a few different effects. Kathy Nolan is watching. He asks the viola to play on the other side of the bridge.
So makes some other nasty noises like...
a few times, and that comes in the middle section. He asks for the cello to do a sort of strumming. And I have to thank Tom, because he gave me a fingering a few days ago. For decades I've been playing. And this is much better. So thank you, Tom. But he gets his moment of glory as well, because he's asked to go right up the G string. I wanted to know, just the beginning. Yes, so it gives a sort of opinion, a sort of quite a strained and intense sound. It's got a sort of feel, I suppose, of Shostakovich in some ways. You know, they knew each other well. And it's sort of a parody, I suppose, a caricature and sending it up in a way. And I remember talking to the composer David Matthews, and met him once, and he said that he and his brother, Colin, played this through before it was actually, it had been finished, but the string parts hadn't been written out, and they played it through to him, actually on his deathbed. And they got to the end, and he just turned to David and he said, "Do you think it's any good?" So it's got a nice story there, but we'll let you judge. We think it's a masterpiece.
It's actually the fourth movement. The last movement is very peaceful, finished. But
did I say that? It's the penultimate.
Thank you. Thank you.